Hello viewers and welcome to another live action commentated match of Warhammer 40,000 Conquest. My name is Mitch and I am the Hive Tyrant. Today I'm honored to share with you the second of a series of 8 total matches each supplied to me by the gentleman sitting to the right. His name is Anton Elizarov, and together these 8 games chronicle the events of the 2015 Conquest LCG Russian National Championships. Anton is going to be playing as our second to be released Space Marines faction warlord Ragnar Blackmane, and at the opposite end of the table sits Igor Treznukov, who's going to be playing as an alternate art version of the original Eldar faction warlord Eldorath Starbane. Igor is going to be holding our initiative token, and it looks as though both of our players have put an early game economy unit onto the table. For Igor, to the left, we've got a copy of the +1 card bonus Void Pirate positioned at planet number 5, whereas on the opposite end of the table, we've got the +1 resource token bonus Rogue Trader currently garrisoned at planet number 3. In assessing our opening lineup of planets, planet number 1 is going to be Karnath. If you win a battle at that planet, you're allowed the opportunity to trigger the battle ability of any other planet in play. Planet number 2 is going to be our healing planet Iridial, whereas planet number 3 is going to be Barless, the forced random card discard planet. Planet number 4, should you end up winning a battle at that location and you control fewer units than does your opponent, you've got your choice of either accumulating 3 additional resource tokens out of the token bank, or adding the top 3 cards off the top of your deck and adding each and every one of those to your hand. Finally, our 5th planet is going to be Farron, which allows you to rout a target non-warlord unit. Note, on the right side of the table, played by Anton, we've got not only his own Void Pirate, but we've also got a copy of Promotion affixed to it, which is going to boost it up to 3 command icons, which is now met on the opposite end of the table with a copy of Slith Mercenary, a 1-cost, 2-attack, 2-hit point unit with 2 command icons, but you can opt to pay 2 resources to purchase control of that unit, and it looks as though that is exactly what we've seen Ragnar do. So now, Ragnar not only has a combat unit stationed at that planet, unless Igor decides to purchase it back, but he's also got a whopping 5 command icons. At planet number 4, for our Eldorath Starbane player, we've got a copy of the signature army unit Starbane's Council. For the cost of 3, it's got a command icon, it's got 3 attack value, also 3 associated hit points, and whenever it's so fortunate as to be declaring an attack against an already exhausted target, it ends up gaining a +2 attack value bonus for a grand total of 5. And note, we've got a Space Marines faction signature army unit, the 2-cost, 2-attack, 2-hit point, 1 command icon, Blackmane Sentinel, positioned at planet number 3. Wherever Ragnar Blackmane ends up being commit as a reaction, you can, should it prove, beneficial to do so, you're allowed the opportunity to relocate your Blackmane Sentinel. But looks like Ragnar's going to show up at planet number 1. Eldorath instead goes to planet number 5. Ragnar's ability is, if he's commit to the same planet as an enemy warlord, you have the opportunity to deal 2 damage to the target unit of your choice, whereas Eldorath, as we can clearly see, exhausts units. So that Slith Mercenary is going to be knocked out. Eldorath is going to have the opportunity to potentially kill off that Void Pirate, but in the meantime, planet number 1 is going to be a card and a resource to the right for Ragnar. Planet number 2 is going to be no contest whatsoever. Planet number 3 is going to be a total of 2 cards and 1 resource, because Ragnar was able to win the battle at that planet. Note, had he chosen to relocate that copy of Blackmane Sentinel, he would not have won the cards or resource bonus afforded by that Rogue Trader, so sometimes it's really only good to relocate those signature army units if absolutely necessary to do so. And of course, it's, left sitting at a planet, so it's not going to be swept into Ragnar's HQ, and it's not going to subsequently show up during the following round's command phase at a planet exhausted. But Taurus is going to be a card and a resource there to the left for Eldorath. Note, Karnath was captured by Anton. That's going to be a red material, a blue technology icon added to his victory display. Looks as though he decided to trigger the planet Farron. Our current fifth planet, that's going to be a routed copy of Starbane's Council. It's going to subsequently show up to combat exhausted. And wouldn't you know it, here at planet number five, where Eldorath showed up, he won himself a couple of resources and a card. He purchases control of that Slith mercenary. Granted, it's still exhausted. Kind of a little bit of a shame that, you know, he decided to exhaust it once both players had commit their warlords to the same planet, and Eldorath kind of knew full well what to expect in regard to what his opponent would have at his disposal. But maybe Eldorath is just trying to kind of convince his opponent here to keep purchasing control of that Slith mercenary. But regardless, Eldorath there at planet number five is going to take a swing at that Void Pirate after Igor's Void Pirate took a swing. And now let's see if we have any shields discarded. Looks as though the answer is going to be no. That's going to be a dead Void Pirate and that limited keyword promotion now gone. So Eldorath is going to have an opportunity here to trigger a route, and it looks as though that is going to be the Rogue Trader being evicted from that planet. So the trick here is Igor's got a Rogue Trader positioned at planet number two, but if any point that Blackmane Sentinel gets relocated away from that planet, then Igor is going to stand to basically benefit from drawing two additional cards and a resource, because suddenly he'll be winning command at that planet as opposed to just tying up command at that planet. So we've got an HQ phase having come and gone. That's going to be our initiative token bouncing over to Anton. Now we've got our new fifth planet being Aatrox Prime. It affords you the opportunity to pick the enemy HQ or an adjacent planet and deal out 1 point of damage to each and every unit, each and every enemy unit present at that planet. Note, wherever Eldorath ends up going, an exhausted copy of Starbane's Council is going to be showing up alongside him. And then for Ragnar, wherever Ragnar goes, he's also going to be bringing, ferrying that Rogue Trader. Note, exhausted units, of course, don't contribute their command icons to winning command struggles, but the same cannot be said for resource and card bonuses. Generally, warlords win command struggles by default, so it's definitely not the worst thing in the world to end up seeing a rogue trader moving alongside one's warlord. So I'll be curious to see if not choosing to route that Blackmane Sentinel ends up coming back to kind of haunt our Eldorath Starbane player, but looks like we've started to see a fair few additional deploy actions. On the left side of the table, we've got a plus one card bonus Void Pirate at planet number five, and on the right side of the table, we've got a plus one resource bonus Rogue Trader garrisoned at planet number two. Stationed at planet number three, we've got a one cost, one command icon, two attack, one hit point, 10th Company Scout. It's a Space Marine faction unit. Even though it doesn't have a card or resource bonus associated with it, it's drop pod assault eligible, it's indomitable eligible, you can use crushing blow, and any number of other effects. So it's pretty cheap, it packs quite a bit of a punch, and it looks as though, speaking of a bit of a punch, each of our player puts out one of those warlord friend units. We've got the Dark Eldar vehicle trait unit, the Bloodied Reavers, positioned at planet number one for Eldorath. It's a 2-2 with the command icon for two, and then it gets a plus two attack bonus whenever a warlord is present. And then on our Space Marine side of the table, we've got a copy of the three cost, one command, three hit point, two attack, plus two attack value whenever a warlord is present, White Scars Biker. And that means that if neither warlord shows up, then our Space Marine is at a considerable advantage, not only because he has initiative, but also because he's, you know, got one greater hit point. So even if the Bloodied Reaver swings back and doesn't destroy the White Scars Biker, the Biker might have two opportunities to attack, or the Bloodied Reavers will have an opportunity to retreat after wounding the White Scars Biker, and then Iridial can resolve and end up healing the Biker. But we've started to see still additional units hit the tabletop. We've got another 10th Company Scout at planet number 5. We've got a Rogue Trader at planet number 5. Both of our players are going to be tied for command icons at that planet, and now both Ragnar and Eldorath are definitely going to be encouraged to show up at planet number 5 just to try to ensure that they can get those big, hefty card and resource bonuses here. But it looks as though the earliest we could possibly see a victory condition is going to be for our player to the right at planet number 3, and just in regard to where it would be beneficial to send units, Eldorath could certainly stand to show up at planet number 1, knock out that copy of the White Scars Biker, attack the White Scars Biker for 4 with the Bloodied Reavers, have Eldorath take a swing, kill off the Biker. Even if things start to go really bad, start to turn sideways, if everything seems to turn into a bit of dog shit, Iridial could pull a ton of damage off of Eldorath, so that could be a hotly contested planet, but we'll have to see how many resources our Space Marine player ends up with, just because Drop Pod Assault and Eager Recruit are definitely monumentally threatening when you're up against a Space Marine, and Ragnar himself, if he goes to the first planet, he's going to maintain initiative. If Eldorath shows up at that planet, he's going to have the opportunity to pick and choose any enemy unit to deal 2 damage to, like that copy of the Bloodied Reavers, so we'll have to see how things break down. At planet number 2, that Blackmane Sentinel is already losing command, so it would definitely make sense to relocate that further upstream should Ragnar show up at planet number 1, and our Space Marine player looks like he's got a total of 7 units relative to our 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 units for the Eldorath player, so looks like Taurus could potentially stand to be activated by Ragnar, and that would also serve to give him the considerable added benefit of trumping that copy of Slith Mercenary sitting at planet number 3 and blocking off our 10th company scout there. So looks like Ragnar shows up at planet number 2. That means he's going to block the enemy's 2 cards and 1 resource bonus. Ragnar is going to be able to get a +1 resource bonus of his own thanks to that rogue trader. And I suppose I'm not tremendously surprised to see Eldorath show up at planet number 1. That seemed like a cogent approach to the game here. And similarly, you know, Ragnar is going to want to do as much damage as possible to the enemy economy just because he doesn't want to get behind. And you know, if Eldorath's showing up to planet number 1, that just means that Bloodied Reavers, that Starbane's Council, they're going to be showing up the following turn exhausted, so that's going to make it all the more likely that our Space Marine is potentially going to be able to try and KO some of those units. And whether or not he deals with Eldorath directly, if you've got a bunch of exhausted units, you could potentially throw out Drop Pod Assaults and Eager Recruits once Eldorath is safely exhausted, and you need not worry about Nullify, just so you can surprisingly, you know, unexpectedly drop out Space Marine units, and then Honored Librarian, Blood Angels Veterans, White Scars Bikers, all of those powerful units could potentially stand to kill off those Eldar and Dark Eldar units, regardless of initiative, prior to their opportunity to be ready, and you know, come back and get you. I definitely think something that I've started to value more and more as a player myself is just trying to delay your victory condition as long as possible and just simply allow your opponent a lot of opportunities to make mistakes. So, looks like things were about to get pretty interesting, but they are actually still quite interesting. So, our initiative player triggered a reaction. Ragnar Blackmane was going to use Blackmane's Hunt to relocate himself to planet number 1, but Eldorath Starbane used he basically played the event Nullify as part of the cost he exhausted a unique Eldar faction unit, namely Eldorath Starbane, to cancel the relocation of Ragnar, which would have meant Ragnar would have shown up to that planet. He'd have had the opportunity to deal 2 points of damage to a unit present at that planet. So planet number 1, note that copy of White Scar's Biker is going to be exhausted thanks to Eldorath. That's going to be a card won by Eldorath, and that Bloodied Reavers takes a swing, that's going to be a dead copy of the White Scars Bikers, but Iridial is going to do absolutely nothing being won by our Eldorath player, apart from adding a planet type icon of each kind to his victory display. At planet number 2, like I mentioned before, that's going to be a couple of cards +1 resource to Ragnar Blackmane. Planet number 3, that's going to be a card and a resource for Eldorath. Planet number 4 is going to be 2 resources and a card for Eldorath, whereas planet number 5, probably fortunate for our Space Marine. At the very least, Eldorath did not win at that planet, even though our Space Marine didn't win at that planet either. So, looks like that Blackmane Sentinel takes a swing. That's going to be a dead copy of Slith Mercenary. Ragnar Blackmane himself takes a swing. That's going to be a dead copy of the Rogue Trader at the end of combat. That's going to be a random card discarded. That's going to be Superiority. Very divisive card in this community. It's great for, shutting off your opponent's ability to play certain cards. Like, if your opponent has one resource, they're about to win a couple resources, you can play Superiority to shut off one of the units, like one of their units at a planet. You basically cancel out each and every one of their command icons. So if your opponent is expecting to use Drop Pod Assault and you can suddenly disallow them from taking advantage of such a powerful event, then that could make a big bit of difference. But keep in mind, you are investing a card and a resource often to just shut off your opponent's access to the very same. So a lot of people aren't thrilled about Superiority. Some people love it, but your mileage may vary. So that battle with Ragnar has been resolved. That means we've seen an HQ phase come and go. Both of our players are going to collect four resources. They're going to draw two cards. We've got a new fifth and final planet of the match. It is Yavarn. Should you win a battle at Yavarn and you're one of those crazy players that actually triggers that battle ability, that necessitates both players to pick an army unit from their hand and put that into play directly into their HQ. Note, our initiative token is once again in the possession of our Eldar faction player. He spends two resources to put into play a Warlock Destructor positioned at planet number one. So that is going to be a 3-4 unit with a command icon for the low, low cost of two resources during your deploy phase. You're forced to pay a resource or otherwise that has to be leaving play. Looks like our Space Marine threw out another copy of Blackmane Sentinel to planet number four to try to beat that command deadlock, and the deadlock continues. One of these players should hope for a copy of Promotion. Looks like that's another copy of Rogue Trader, so Eldorath is definitely going to be heavily incentivized to at least consider showing up to that planet. The trouble with Eldorath going to planet number four is that would drop off Starbane's Council and the Bloodied Reavers outside of his victory condition. Ragnar, it might be useful for Ragnar to show up at that planet just to try to kill off all these different enemy economy units, but if you can just trump him in command, then that also works. Note, the addition of a 10th Company Scout, a second copy of 10th Company Scout to that planet means that Ragnar is currently in the lead, but Eldorath has got to be really frustrated with the notion that he's got a plus two resource and a one card bonus at that planet. So, if Eldorath could win command at planet number four, whether it's through Superiority or whether it's through having Eldorath show up, knock out an enemy unit, or whatever it happens to be, we could even see Eldorath show up at planet number one, drop off his units, then use Foresight to relocate to Aatrox Prime, and then win command, and that would be a grand total of two cards and three resources. And we've definitely yet to see our Eldorath player use any of his signature events, but let's see here. Eldorath could win the game as early as planet number two if he's aggressive, if he doesn't take any foolish or unnecessary risks. What's great for Eldorath is the relocatable Blackmane Sentinels. He'll be able to show up at planet number one and KO one of those units. Something that kind of sucks is, like, if Eldorath were to show up at planet number one and there were no enemy units located at that planet, if Eldorath, with the initiative, decided not to trigger a reaction because there are no eligible targets, then Ragnar, like if Ragnar showed up at planet number one as well, he could have relocated one of those Blackmane Sentinels after Eldorath had already given up his opportunity to exhaust one. But looks as though both of our players are going to send their respective warlords to planet number two, and that means all kind of shenanigans are about to occur. So Eldorath is going to knock out that copy of the 10th Company Scout. Let's see if Blackmane Sentinel from any of these planets ends up being relocated. So what is Ragnar going to damage with his reaction? a prime target is definitely going to be that Bloodied Reavers, because it's going to threaten to swing for four, but that copy of Slith Mercenaries is currently ready, so it's going to be able to have the opportunity to attack. Note that we've yet to collect our resources, but already our Space Marine players got an adequate number of resource tokens with which to play a drop pod assault, which could be absolutely integral, and the instant that Eldorath ends up being exhausted, like let's say Eldorath takes an attack at Ragnar, then Ragnar attacks probably the Bloodied Reavers, then we could see a drop pod assault, maybe throw out an Honored Librarian, and then that could potentially kill off the copy of Starbane's Council. But planet number one, that's going to be two cards and resource one by Anton to the right. Planet number two is going to be, looks like neither of our players is going to end up winning, but looks like we see a copy of Primal Howl, yet another reaction played, so it's going to be Eldorath's reaction, Ragnar's reaction, Eldorath passes on additional reactions, there's no foresight to be played, and then we see a copy of Primal Howl there. That's going to be three cards drawn for our Space Marine player, but planet number three is going to be a couple of resources and a card accrued by our Eldar player. Planet number four is going to be a whopping two resources and one card for our Space Marine, so it's definitely a bit of a shame that Eldorath didn't have the opportunity to collect that mountain of bonuses afforded to him by the Void Pirate and that duo of rogue traders. And of course, Yavarn, kind of the, I don't want to really say it, but the red-headed stepchild of our 10 planets. Nobody ever really wants to go there. It's just one resource. It allows you to put army units into play, but it allows your opponent the same opportunity, so therefore it's definitely not something we see activated every day. But we're going to see a battle erupt at planet number one. We're also going to see a battle go on at planet number two, and that is presumably going to be the entirety of our combat phase here. So, looks like our Eldar players got the initiative token. That Warlock Destructor is going to be able to take a swing, likely kill off the Blackmane Sentinel, unless the Blackmane Sentinel has a two-value shield card to make sure it isn't destroyed, or we see a copy of Indomitable, and it looks as though we're going to see an additional reaction. So it seems as though I spoke too soon. Blackmane Sentinel is going to be relocated from planet number four to planet number two, and therefore I'm going to be very curious indeed to see if the Blackmane Sentinel is going to be moved from planet number one as well. I can only imagine that we decided to move the one from planet number four just because Ragnar must be in desperate desire of cards. Note, he's basically turning down two resources and a card just to gain the added benefit of having that Blackmane Sentinel positioned at that planet. And even though I already covered it, looks like our players are just now going through the different planets and collecting all of their economy bonuses here. So, our Eldar players got six resources. What exactly does that mean? It means we could see a couple copies of Empower played that give plus one attack and plus one hit point to each and every Eldar faction unit until the remainder of, I believe, the phase at a target planet, but that's not going to help Dark Eldar faction units. At planet number one, that Warlock Destructor took a swing at that Blackmane Sentinel. We saw an Iron Halo discarded as shields. 3-2 is, of course, 1, so therefore Blackmane Sentinel is going to be surviving. It itself is going to take a swing. Do we see a double crushing blow? I would imagine we do not. But let's see how things break down. We might see an eager recruit, is what I would say, but we've come to the end of a combat round. All of our units are already being readied. And therefore, yeah, top of the new combat round, the Warlock Destructor takes a swing at the Blackmane Sentinel. That's going to be a one resource cost Indomitable. The Blackmane Sentinel is going to take a swing. Do we see a one or two value shield card? Do we have a crushing blow in our Space Marine player's hand? Definitely I would advise saving crushing blow until you're going to be dealing out the absolute final killing blow. And it looks as though Blackmane Sentinel, like a devious little bit of a bastard, oh, that about sucks. So that's another thing you can see with an abundance of, free resources, is that Blackmane Sentinel is going to be killed. So after it took a swing, there's an action window. We saw Gift of Isha, the Warlock Destructor, shows up. That means Barliss is going to be one. The unit that Gift of Isha resurrects does not actually leave play until the end of the phase, so the discard there was a little bit premature. We're kind of correcting for that mistake, it looks like. But basically, the point I'm trying to convey is that the unit lasts long enough to actually manage to capture the first planet. So Eldrath managed to capture Barliss. That's going to be a random card discard. Looks like Ragnar caught a very lucky break indeed in regard to what he actually ended up discarding. It's going to be a copy of Ragnar's War Camp, the 3-cost signature support, that I believe at the same planet as your Warlord, any Space Wolves trait unit ends up dealing double damage to the enemy Warlord exclusively, I believe is how that is phrased. So, as I would imagine, you can clearly surmise that's definitely not something that a Ragnar Blackmane running player puts out every day, and especially considering that at the time of this video, Lone Wolf did not exist, you definitely don't see Ragnar's War Camp being played too often. But looks like battle is going to break out at planet number 2. Eldorath Starbane uses his action to retreat from that planet, and that is very interesting. So Eldorath has retreated. Part of retreating, especially as a combat action, means that your Warlord is going to be retreated. So if we end up seeing a drop pod assault, that means that Eldorath is not going to be able to use an ability to, nullify that. He's not going to be able to pay that requisite cost because there's no Spirit Seer Aerithal, there's no Autarch Selakia, there's no Eldorath Starbane ready to cancel that effect. So that copy of Bloodied Reavers is going to be quite handily killed off. That copy of Starbane's Council has taken 2 points of damage. I would imagine it's going to hang out at this planet. Starbane's Council is going to be able to attack for 3, so it could kill off the 10th Company Scout. It could potentially kill off that Blackmane Sentinel, unless we see another 2-value shield card, which is exactly what we see. We do see a 2-value shield card, Iron Halo, discarded, but it's going to be an attack directed toward Ragnar Blackmane, so he is only going to end up taking 1 point of damage, and then the 10th Company Scout, that 1 HP unit, proves himself. He draws first blood. He's made it into the Adeptus Astartes, the Angels of Death. Congratulations, 10th Company Scout. You've made it into the big leagues. That's going to be a dead copy of Starbane's Council. Ragnar's going to bounce back to his HQ. And let's do a real quick unit count. I count 6. Well, I guess it would have been 7 units in total for Eldorath. And then that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 units for our Space Marine player. So that about sucks that our Space Marine was unfortunately not able to derive benefit from Taurus. Note that that Gift of Isha unit remained in play until the very end of the phase there, so both of our players were in, you know, kind of dead even for unit count. And now something just critically important to consider is that our Space Marine is going to have to block off each and every green strong point icon possessing planet to ensure that Eldorath is not going to be able to achieve victory. So if Taurus ends up being lost, then that is going to be Anton losing the game. Looks like we've got a promotion now affixed to that 10th Company Scout at planet number 3. Eldorath, it's looking like his HQ is free, so if Eldorath wants, he could show up at planet number 3. But that wouldn't be the worst destination for Ragnar as well, just to shut off all that enemy command. We've already seen at least one copy of Gift of Isha. I think a lot of what I would do is Ragnar is going to hinge entirely upon what exactly my opponent deploys. I think the topmost card of our Eldar player's discard pile would be that copy of Warlock Destructor, because it remains in play until the end of the phase. That Starbane's Council would be in the discard pile before the Destructor, so we could see a Gift of Isha or 2 recur a copy of Warlock Destructor to planet number 1, but if we don't see anything really significant being put out to planet number 1, then Ragnar need not necessarily send himself to planet number 1 if he's not, you know, if the opponent isn't really going to try to push to win the game this round, then play accordingly and try to salvage any kind of Just benefit that you can. Looks like we've got two rogue traders and two void pirates positioned at planet number four. That is absolutely ridiculous for our Eldar player. That is probably the most of those economy units I've ever seen piled all at one planet, and that is making for a highly entertaining display. But planet number one, we've got some excitement going on. Looks as though both of our players are slowly but surely starting to whittle down their available resources. Definitely much more so for our Space Marine than our Eldar player, who's been doing much better economically over the course of this video. But planet number one, we've got a copy of the 2-command icon, 2-cost, 3-attack, 1-hit-point Incubus Warrior positioned at planet number one. Although what sucks is it's only got 1 hit point, and who has the initiative token? The answer is Ragnar Blackmane. Also at planet number one, something just very frustrating to see for any player is going to be a copy of Honored Librarian. Granted, Eldorath is pretty damn decent at exhausting stuff, like, you know, Honored Librarian, but what doesn't he have? He doesn't really have any kind of direct damage, he doesn't have any kind of area effect outside of Autark Selakia, and therefore that Honored Librarian is going to be a monumental pain in the ass to try to kill, because with or without copies of Crushing Blow, even if you end up using a copy or two of Gift of Isha, Honored Librarian can make pretty short work of a repeatedly resurrected Warlock Destructor, and then you're using valuable events, you're using up cards that you could be using as shields, so things are starting to look a little bit difficult for Eldorath Starbane here. Ragnar, it definitely wouldn't be the worst idea in the world for him to potentially look to just hurt his opponent's economy as much as possible. Eldorath, I don't think will be going to planet number one. Planet number two, that seems a little bit silly for Eldorath to show up to. Eldorath runs a bit of a risk. Like, if Eldorath goes to planet number three, he might be able to win a large amount of economy, but then he triggers a battle, and the 10th Company scouts, that Blackmane Sentinel, all of those are going to serve to kill off all of his economy units, and then Aatrox Prime could take a shot at planet number two, kill off that Void Pirate, wound that copy of Slith Mercenaries. Looks like Ragnar Blackmane is going to show up at planet number two. We see another copy, the second copy of that signature event, Blackmane's Hunt. Well, it is successfully played, but its effects are going to be canceled, and that about sucks for Eldorath, because what do we see at planet number one? Eldorath shows up, he manages to exhaust that enemy Honored Librarian, but now that's going to be two resources in the possession of our Space Marines player, and Eldorath is exhausted. 10th Company Scout or Blackmane Sentinel is going to be able to quite handily kill off that copy of Incubus Warrior, though the Incubus Warrior will have the opportunity to attack first, because Eldorath essentially stole command, because Blackmane wasn't able to reload himself, but maybe our Space Marine is going to be using Indomitable, and would you look at that massive amount of income there. So, planet number one is going to be a card and a resource for Eldorath. Planet number two is going to be three resources in total for Ragnar. A lot of money to fund Indomitable, Drop Pod Assault, Eager Recruit, all manner of horrific different effects, and consider, too, that it's Ragnar basically has to win at this planet. Incubus Warrior takes a swing. That's going to be 10th Company Scout killed, and I believe this is probably a little bit premature. I'm not sure exactly why you would do this right now, but Eager Recruit drops into play. It's going to be able to kill off that copy of Incubus Warrior. Keep in mind, alright, looks like that's going to be a copy of Gift of Isha being played, and that's going to be that Warlock Destructor being brought to play. It's going to take a swing, and it is, let's see, I can't quite tell, maybe that was a copy of Primal Howl discarded as shield, so again, it's doubly unfortunate that Ragnar wasn't able to move to planet number one, but Primal Howl is going to mean that the Blackmane Sentinel survives. That's going to be a Drop Pod Assault, and while my dear friend Sir Anton is taking a look at the top six cards of his deck for any Space Marine faction unit he would like. Wow. So he comes across Veteran Brother Maxos. Veteran Brother Maxos is going to be able to take a swing and potentially kill off that Warlock Destructor. The Warlock Destructor is going to be dead, but perhaps we'll see an additional copy of Gift of Isha. I believe our Eldar player has a third copy somewhere in his deck. We're finally going to come to the end of a combat round. Note, that's going to be Eldorath Starbane retreating from that planet. What's great about Veteran Brother Maxos is it allows you, as a combat action, to pay the cost associated with any Space Marines faction unit, like 10th Company Scout, in your hand, and put it into play at that planets. So deploy and put into play are two disparate concepts, and definitely putting into play can be beneficial in working around effects like Siren Zithlex and any number of other things. But Ragnar Blackmane took a swing. He killed off that copy of the Slith Mercenary, that rogue trader. At the end of combat, has the opportunity to retreat into Eldorath's HQ. Looks like he's got, a rogue trader with a promotion and a void pirate in his HQ as well. Ragnar had the opportunity to rout a target army unit, and looks like he decided to get rid of an economy unit. And again, that's always an interesting choice, just because by kicking economy units into your opponent's HQ, if they've got a card bonus, if they've got a resource bonus, that's going to result in those units, showing up alongside your warlord, and you're still going to be getting that resource or card bonus if you win command. So we saw a Doom. If you missed my reaction, that's going to be Honored Librarian dead. That's, a 10th Company Scout dead, Blackmane Sentinel dead. It was also that Rogue Trader and Void Pirate gone. So that was four resources that hopefully for Eldorath's sake were very well played indeed. During the previous round, that was a great showing once again. You know, by having all those army units and the economy units stacked at planet number two, our Space Marine player was able to accrue two resources and a card, and it looks as though our players are already hitting the command phase here. So Ragnar shows up at planet number one. He brings that copy of the unique, not destroyed, veteran brother Maxos with him, and this is very interesting indeed. Looks like we see that Blackmane Sentinel relocate itself to planet number one after being exhausted by Eldorath Starbane, and I guess that is the victory condition planet for our Space Marine player. So what exactly do we have for our Eldar player? Does he have anything to know? That looks like that is going to be the game. So that is the GG right there. Congratulations to Anton Elizarov for managing to pilot this one home right when Eldorath was at the very brink of being able to win this game. Our Space Marine played relatively cautiously. He tried to, you know, really use action advantage to his benefit. He gave up resources, he gave up cards in favor of relocating Blackmane Sentinels to where they would be of the utmost use to him. He used them as an opportunity to kill off some of the daunting enemy combat units like the Bloodied Reavers, the Warlock Destructor, the Starbane's Council, even without a monumental number of, you know, drop pod assaults and cards like that. Our Space Marine player was able to do just fine, having veteran brother Maxos at that planet, having accumulated quite a few resources by that final round of combat. He'd have been able to dump out potentially a couple of copies of the Honored Librarian that I happened to spy in his hand, but this was an excellent game. Thank you to both of our players for providing me with the opportunity to witness this match, taken from the rounds of Swiss from the Russian 2015 National Championship. So well played by Igor Treznukov. Well played, and congratulations to Anton Elizarov. And as always, if you enjoyed this content, be sure to hit that like button and subscribe to my channel if you've not done so already, or if you are already subscribed, as ever, you're always encouraged to share this content, because the more individuals there are that stumble upon these videos, the more people may give Conquest a try, end up playing this living card game, join our community, and of course, the more we are in number, the more likely Fantasy Flight Games is to continue to develop this fantastic card game for years and years to come. If at any point you'd like to get in touch with me, I would encourage you to do so through Facebook or on Twitter, and if you ever feel so inclined to help support the Hive Tyrant and improve this channel, I would be absolutely honored, humbled, and flattered were you to consider donating a dollar or two on a strictly monthly basis to my Patreon. But once again, thank you so much for watching, and as always, be sure to check back in again soon for much more Conquest LCG content to come.